You just have to make sure it's on. All right, welcome everybody. Let's get started. I want to welcome all of you to Frontiers in the Environment. I'm Ellen Anderson, Executive Director of the Energy Transition Lab. I'm delighted to be with you today and with our fantastic panel of experts. We encourage you to tweet and use the hashtag Frontiers, or at, yes, and everything else is written down up here, at INE. So as you know, here we are today to talk about whether energy storage is the game changer we've been looking for. It's not exactly a debate, it's more of a discussion. And I'm gonna start by setting the stage just a little bit, give a little bit of background, very brief, and a couple of kind of paradigm busters that I think storage might entail, which is why I think energy storage is a game changer. So, let's start with, figuring out how to do this. There we go. So the first big thing, the big factoid that you should know is that the costs are dropping dramatically for energy storage. The trajectory will look very familiar to what's happened to wind energy and to solar energy. It's been coming down in cost, and experts expect that to continue for years to come and potentially up to a 70% reduction in cost over the next coming years. Second, we're in a period of energy transition. Our system is transitioning dramatically from traditional central power stations controlled by one entity to a variety of different distributed, renewable, dispersed energy sources that are variable in output. And are enabled by two-way communications and controls. So things are very different in the energy system. So how does this, combined with energy storage, disrupt traditional paradigms? I'm gonna give you three quick paradigm busters, as I mentioned. First, the electricity system always has to instantaneously match supply and demand for reliable power. Now that's still true, that's not changing. But what is changing is that if energy storage is cost effective, it can be used to fill in those gaps in a new way. Secondly, energy generation or supply is designed or managed to meet the forecasted load. So supply follows demand traditionally, but the new paradigm says that we can control demand and we can shift demand and demand can follow supply rather than the other way around. So with storage or with demand response, we can change when we use our electricity. And I want to give you an example. Dispatchable demand can be as valuable as generation. For example, in MISO, does everybody know what MISO is? The system operator in the Midwest and beyond. In MISO, 6.5% of wind generation is curtailed. That's worth $50 million a year of electricity, renewable, clean electricity that's thrown away because we can't use it, because it's produced at times of the day when consumers aren't using very much electricity. So think about if we can store and save that energy and we can move that demand and that usage to a different time. That can save money and help our electricity system and promote more renewable sources of electricity. And another paradigm I want to mention, this is about how we build for the conventional energy system. Traditionally, we overbuild. Think about when we build freeways. If we built every freeway to have 16 lanes to manage rush hour for a few hours of the year, that's a little bit like how we build our current electricity system, because it has to meet the peak, the very highest moment or hours of peak demand in the year. And in Minnesota and in MISO, what's called the load factor is flat or even declining. And that means in Minnesota, for example, only 55% of our capacity is used in an average year. So we are building excess capacity like peaking gas plants that are only used for maybe 100 hours of the year. And that means the system's getting less efficient. We're spending a lot of money on this capacity. But right now, the new paradigm is that right now in the US, projects are being built to use energy storage to replace gas peaking plants. So that's a big paradigm disruptor. I mentioned in the description of this that energy storage is known as the Swiss Army knife of the electrical grid, and that's because there are so many different uses of energy storage, different applications. I won't go into this. Maybe we'll hear more about it from our panelists. But some of these can be done at the same time or by the same energy storage system, I should say. One system can serve multiple purposes and produce multiple benefits, potentially. And finally, round peg square hole. Energy storage doesn't fit our traditional regulatory regimes. We have federal markets that are wholesale, we have regional markets, and we have local distribution markets that are regulated by state legislators and by public utilities commissioners. And energy storage can have different hats and be a different asset that fits into all different ones of those regulatory regimes, depending on what it happens to be doing at that moment. So there's a lot of work to be done to make this round peg a square peg. And our Minnesota Energy Storage Alliance, which the Energy Transition Lab convenes, is working to figure that out. So that's my real quick perspective. And now I want to turn it over to our experts who will provide some other perspectives from a variety of different backgrounds. We'll start with Brian Burandt, who's the Vice President of Power Supply and Business Development at Connexus Energy, which is a distribution cooperative in Ramsey, Minnesota, and it is the largest electric co-op in the state of Minnesota. One of Brian's current initiatives is to develop distribution scale interconnected solar projects with better economics. After him will be Ron Nelson, who's a consumer advocate. He works as an economist with the Minnesota Attorney General's Office in the Residential Utilities and Antitrust Division, which advocates for ratepayers, which means you and I, at the Public Utilities Commission. Ron specializes in cost of service modeling, rate design, and utility business models, and his slides represent his own opinions. We have two research scientists with us today. And Ned Mohan, to my next left, is a distinguished engineering professor and has taught at the University of Minnesota since 1976. He's an IEEE fellow, elected to the National Academy of engineering, among many, many other honors, which I cannot list today, or we'd run out of time. He specializes in sustainable energy systems and power electronics and drives. And finally, last but not least, from Duluth, Don Fosnacht, Associate Director of the Natural Resources Research Institute, which is part of UMD. And besides that role, Don leads NRRI's work on renewable energy, and he's a metallurgical engineer, works in things like mineral, steel, new iron-making technologies, and energy research and development, including converting biomass to useful fuel and chemical products, and energy storage technologies, which he's going to talk about today. So I'm going to turn it over to Brian. There you go.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Can everybody hear me? Conexus Energy, we're a member-owned distribution cooperative. We have approximately 1,000 square miles of service area in the 7-county North Metro area. We're an all-requirements member of Great River Energy. They're a generation and transmission company located in Maple Grove. They serve approximately 2/3 of the state. All those shaded cooperatives are 28 of the cooperative owners of Great River Energy. I joked with Alan that member advocacy, member advocate, is a cooperative. We are a member advocate. We're owned by our members. We operate in our members' best interest. As part of our strategic planning session last summer, we surveyed the members to see what was important to them, to what we should be focusing on. And the traditional rates, as far as affordability and reliability, are always high. But the third R is renewables. Our membership is telling us we want you to increase your green portfolio. Currently, 20% of the electrons we provide are carbon-free. So we asked them, again, the question, you want us to be a renewable, how much are you willing to pay? And overwhelmingly, the answer is zero. So therefore, I'm charged with finding innovative ways to add renewables to our system in a manner that does not increase rates. With the approval of the 2015 omnibus bill that extended the investment tax credits for renewable projects and the inclusion of storage, it made the reality of doing solar plus storage a reality. And as a result of that, we did a business case internally to justify doing an RFP that we will be releasing next month for 10 megawatts of solar and 20 megawatts of demand response storage technology. Within our contract with GE rates, all requirements, but we have the option to pursue up to 5% of our energy needs from renewable systems as long as they're located within our service territory. Those of you familiar with wind resource maps, we don't have a lot of wind resources in the North Metro, so we're pretty much limited to doing solar applications. Conexus, we're not a MISO participant. So everything you think about MISO, know about MISO, forget that. GE REIT handles all that transaction for us. GE REIT is an all requirements provider to Conexus. They sell us power and demand. They charge energy on an on and off peak basis, and we have a monthly coincident demand charge of both capacity and transmission. That's our price signal to evaluate the value of solar and also demand response. We also have the two-way transaction from our members. We have 64 PURPA qualifying facilities to buy power from. But from the GE REIT standpoint, there's 730 hours in a month. I'm sorry. And if you look at those electrons that come over that 730 hours, the first 729 kilowatt hours in a month are worth around 5 to 6 cents if you can offset it. But if you can offset that last kilowatt hour, it has a value between $15 to $25, depending upon the seasonality. So demand response is very important. Our strategy of solar plus storage is to align the solar production with our system peak via the storage system. So solar can either feed into the grid, it can feed into the battery system, and then we can discharge the battery system to align with our system peak. Solar, as you probably know, has a maximum output during the midday portion of it. As a cooperative, our load profile is driven by the residential member. So on top of the commercial industrial load, which is pretty much 7 days a week, you have the residential member. When the typical home owner comes home, starts living in the house between the hours of 5 to 7, that drives our system peak. So the strategy is to charge the batteries during the day, and then in the late afternoon over the probable peak hours, discharge those batteries to fully monetize the value of the demand response benefit. Lately, you've been seeing a lot about storage perhaps isn't the best thing because it produces or puts less renewable energy onto the grid. At 10 megawatts of solar, it'd be about 13,000 megawatt hours, roughly 1,300 homes could be powered by the solar system. You have the round trip losses from doing the storage, but the financial reality of doing demand response with the storage system, it boosts on an equivalent basis the electrons hitting the grid by 645%. So it's a financial play, the demand response on top of the investment tax credits that the solar brings to the storage system to get the discount, that brings both parts together as far as the solar and the storage aspect. And that's what I have for the quick 5-minute overview of why we're doing our project. And again, it's to align solar production with our system peak to have the greatest value. Solar on its own doesn't make economic sense as far as the criteria I have to meet. Storage on itself doesn't meet the economic criteria, but when you package the two together in the investment tax credits, it appears to be a game changer.
Click forward one and hand it to Ron.
Thanks. Hello, I'm Ron Nelson. I'm an economist, so I'll be talking about economics. Thank you to Ellen. I will answer Ellen's question very simply. Yes, storage will change the game. I think you can safely assume that with the cost declines that are forecasted, as well as in the future we're going to see more renewables and more likely more distributed renewables. So what a consumer advocate is interested in is how can we change the game equitably? And to do this, I'm going to discuss the services that batteries provide and how we can preserve, how we can ensure there's going to be equity between stakeholder groups and within stakeholder groups when we are paying for those services. So this is a graphic from an MRI, a Rocky Mountain Institute report on the economics of storage. I'm just going to explain the graphic as is and then talk about the economics. There's three customer groups or three stakeholder groups, the customers, the utility, and the ISO, which is the independent system operator. And then there's 13 different services. I'm not going to go through all of the services. But the take-home message of the graphic is that where you install the battery on the power system determines the suite of services that could be offered by a battery. Now, a battery isn't going to offer all 13 services at the same time, but they could potentially be programmed to provide multiple services. Now, take the pink ring is behind the meter. So if a customer installs a battery at their business, they can provide all 13 of these services, potentially. Now, if you're installing the battery at the transmission system, at the ISO level, you can't go back and provide services directly at the distribution system or at the customer premises. All right, so the flow of services kind of go one direction. Now, where the battery is installed is important, but how we pay for these services is also important. Many of these services are not currently paid for, so battery owners have no incentive to provide them. So again, let's look at the ISO. You can install a battery at the transmission level and sell services into a wholesale market. That gives the battery owner a way to monetize these services. But not every stakeholder group can access wholesale markets. A customer can't access a wholesale market, so if they invest in a battery, they can only provide those four services, and they're only to the customer for the most part. So historically, when customers make investments at their business or home, we use what's called an administrative rate as a proxy for the services they provide to the grid. So rooftop solar, for example, provides services to the grid. Regulators, such as myself, get together in a year or 2 year long proceeding and set an administrative rate for rooftop solar, such as the value of solar or a net energy metering rate. Now, that is a gross proxy for the services that are provided by rooftop solar. And the main thing with an administrative rate is that it is wrong. Every single time I set an administrative rate, it's wrong because it doesn't take into consideration time and location. And that creates inequity between stakeholders and within stakeholder groups, because you're paying the wrong price for a resource that's on the grid. So the problem is that we are not paying for battery services in some instances, and then we're using two different mechanisms to procure and compensate battery services: a wholesale market at one end, and then an administrative rate. And like I said, storage isn't using an administrative rate currently, but there has been discussion about a value of storage rate. And so that creates an inequity in itself if you're paying for the same services in different ways or not paying for the services. So the solution is basically we need to start paying for all of the services, but we need to pay all of the stakeholders in a similar fashion. So we need to start moving towards more market-based principles to procure and compensate for the services provided to the grid. And again, if you don't do that, the inequity between stakeholders and within stakeholder groups will increase. For example, if you set the administrative rate too high, you're going to get a ton of storage or rooftop solar. And that can transfer, create a wealth transfer from low income to high income. And you can also hurt utilities that way. And this is a really good example of the square head or the square peg in a circular hole. Just note that it'll take massive regulatory change and lots of time to accomplish that. That is one goal that consumer advocates should have.
Did I use that?
The clicker is right there. Oh, the mic?
Please. Thank you. Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. You can hear me okay, I hope, right? Thank you, Alan, for inviting me here, and good to see you all. I'll be very brief. I have just one slide, so that I have to check here. Yeah, so I have just one slide, so I can't talk too long, right? So my name is Ned Mohan, and I have been teaching here for the last 42 years. And so I was the lucky one to get the first grant that this RDF had, Xcel RDF, working on flywheel energy storage. So I don't know much about storage, but to sell storage to this audience is like selling igloos to Eskimos. So we all concur that we need storage. It's the missing link. It's a missing link. Okay. So I'll basically talk about the research that we are doing. So we have a fairly large grant through RDF, administered by Institute on the Environment. And that grant is to look at the interface between utility scale solar and wind and storage with the utility grid at 34.5 kV. So 34.5 kV has become the de facto collection voltage. And that's pretty high voltage, right? So how do we get there and how we can do some research and make advancements? So a lot of this interface, rather than being at the base of a tower of a windmill, can be in the nacelle, okay? None of that information is on this slide here, okay, what I'm saying. So that's really the challenge that we have, and that's what we're working on. But I think, as you all know, that wind and solar are surging, okay? So wind capacity, installed capacity used to be like 62 gigawatt at the end of 2015, but end of 2016, it's 82 gigawatt. And I know these numbers because I'm teaching a course, EE1701, Energy, Environment, and Society, as we speak, okay? And so I'm trying to convey all this information to, so these are freshmen. And even physics, having taken physics in high school is not a prerequisite, okay? So, you know, we are also trying to promote this course into high schools through our College in the Schools program, CIS program, where students take it in their own schools, taught by their own instructors, and they get University of Minnesota credits. Okay, so that it can be pretty attractive, and we hope to pilot it starting in fall of this year. So it's not too far away. So coming to this particular slide here, you see that we have PVs on one side, and then we have the utility grid on the other side, which is a residential application here. So it could be 120 volts, it could be 240 volts. So how we take this power coming from the PVs and transfer it to the grid, it'll be nice to have batteries in the middle, right? But so, because we know that, you know, there may be excess energy coming from PVs at some time. We can store that in batteries. And then we can supply, when sun is not shining, we can supply that power from batteries to the grid, to this residential grid. So how can we make it very efficient and very low cost and also have very small footprint? So that's a challenge, but I think, so batteries are there in the middle playing a very important role, okay? So what I have learned is that PV cells today are only 1/4 or 1/5 of the cost of the overall system, okay? That means 4/5 of the cost, let's say, is on balance of system, okay? So if you can bring that down, it'll go a long way to accelerate the penetration of PVs, right? And so this power electronic interface that we have here between PVs and the grid, which is shown here, and that's the, you know, the research topic of that young lady in the back. She should be talking about it rather than me. But if you can reduce that, it'll be a tremendous thing. And here, if you have battery storage on this very local level, right, where it's being generated. And what I've also learned is, how am I doing in time, Ellen? Wrap it up. Okay. So, no, professorial 5 minutes can be very long, I think. Okay. So, what I have learned is that, according to NREL, you all know, National Renewable Energy Lab, that roughly 40% of our electricity can be generated by rooftop solar, rooftop PVs, right? So wouldn't it be nice to have that electricity stored locally so it doesn't have to slosh back and forth, right? It's used where it's generated, okay? So this kind of interface has a great deal of potential, and it also relates to a grand challenge research project that we have to grow vegetables in greenhouses using LEDs, which are powered by, PVs and also storage. So when sun is not shining, you can power these LEDs through batteries, and you can extend the sunlight hour, so to speak. So we can grow vegetables in the basement or whatever, right? And someday maybe growing cannabis becomes legal. So I shouldn't say that. Probably I'm being recorded here, but but anyway, so there's a lot of potential. So that could be the future of agriculture in a world that is getting hotter, and water is more scarce than probably anything else. So water scarcity is a big challenge. So this project adds to all that. So thank you. Thank you for having me here.
What I'm going to talk about is how can you actually implement some of these storage technologies. And it turns out that we have a lot of legacy resources in the state of Minnesota that you can take to advantage. And I have two studies that we have undertaken on a team basis across campuses. We had the Institute of the Environment fund these through their initiative for renewable energy in the environment. We had the Humphrey Institute involved, the St. Anthony Falls Laboratory, two civil engineering departments, and our institute up in Duluth, the Natural Resources Research Institute. So the two technologies are based on large-scale energy storage. One is called pump hydro energy storage, and the other is compressed air energy storage. Anybody ever blow up a balloon? Did you ever release that balloon? Well, that basically translate potential energy into kinetic energy. If we take water from one level to the next level and then eventually release that water, you again get kinetic energy. And you can put that through a turbine and you can generate electricity. So the compression of that air takes energy. So you're taking that in times where we may not be using that energy for other purposes. We're compressing it. That's compressed air energy storage. When you need it, you release that compression, and we basically generate the electricity through a turbine. Same thing is true with water. We pump it up to a high level. When we release that water from that higher level, go through a turbine, we again generate electricity. So when we're looking at these two technologies, guess what? They're available today. But you have to have the right situation to be able to use them. So what we did as a study group, we actually looked across Minnesota to see, do we have features that would allow us to implement these type of technologies? And the basic answer up front is yes, we do have situations where you could take advantage of that with the right policies. So we're going to just take a look at why we do this. It turns out that both compressed air energy storage and pump hydro are the ones, let's see, we got a little pointer here, I guess. Let's see, is that the right one here? Yeah, it should be. I don't know, let's see. I guess I can't quite see if it's working here. There we go. You see, it's not showing up on that one. In that right top corner, it's for you, the right top corner, you'll see that they are the largest scale technologies that can be used to store massive amounts of energy. There also happen to be, because of economy of scale, probably the least expensive ways to store those electrons. So we commenced this study to actually look at these things, and some of our participants included Minnesota Power and Great River Energy. So with pump hydro, you have constraints. You have to have certain levels of potential energy that you can generate, and we basically found that we needed about 100 meter differential between the upper reservoir and the bottom reservoir to do it. We also needed enough water so that you can have a 10 hour duration. It turns out that you'd like to have about 35% of the energy generated by your wind or your solar system to be able to capture that, so that when that is not being used, we can basically put that into this energy storage system and use it later. So we studied the Iron Range, which has had 130 years of mining up there, to see if we had those type of situations where we had, say, a pit lake and then another reservoir that was some height above that. And we found that there are about 10 different places on the Iron Range where you could do that. And those sites have also significant potential because they have a lot of infrastructure around them, both electrical grid as well as service folks that can actually help put those type of sites in. The next thing here we looked at was compressed air energy storage. It's a competing technology with pump hydro. And we found that with the same sort of situations across both the Cuyuna Range and the Mesabi Range, you have these situations where there are already caverns that have been created through mining. There's underground mine features, things of that nature that you could use. And you just, like I talked before, you use a compressor to force the air down into a storage site, and then you take it back through an expander and run a turbine. Interesting, we then came across a hybrid technology that basically uses the features that have a little bit of water use as well as air, and that's this hydrostore technique. This has already been demonstrated off of Toronto Island up in Ontario on Lake Ontario, and they have a 1 megawatt demonstration site up there. And this potentially is an ideal situation for Minnesota, where in both these iron ranges we have a lot of deep pit lakes. Some go down over 500 feet deep, and what happens is that you pump the air during the time where you have that excess electricity down into big bladders, like big balloons. And they have those down 300 feet into Lake Ontario right now. And they use the hydraulic pressure of the water to force it out when they need to put it through turbines. And so these technologies basically are very interesting, because Minnesota actually has all the right features to take advantage of these type of technologies and hopefully serve the Midwest and that MISO operation in terms of taking advantage of energy storage. So we think that with the right incentives, and this goes back to the economics of this whole thing in the policy, we think that we have really a real large opportunity, especially we think with this compressed air energy storage using the hydrostore technology, to actually be a player in this area. So hydrostore, unlike other technologies, needs deep water. You don't need to create a cavern. If you don't need to mine the ground, it saves you a lot of money. So it really cuts out a lot of cost. And the cavern creation could also be coupled with future mining activities. For example, if we actually planned ahead, if we did some type of underground mining activity, well, that could be a legacy cavern that you then convert into a situation where you can use compressed air or pumped hydro type systems. So that's what I have.
Great.
Okay.
Thank you so much. So let me grab a mic. Thank you so much. Is this mic working? Yes. We have time for just a few questions. And so please raise your hand if you want to raise a question or a comment. And Kim will come around with a microphone to make sure we record your question, because all of this is being shown online.
I'm happy to do it. Well, I could ask a question of each and every one of you, but Ron, I'm going to ask you a question. It's a very basic one, but of the types of policy changes needed to take this, to change the regulatory market so that a broad range, equitably distributed, people could benefit from providing those services, financially benefit from providing those services. How hard or easy are all the changes needed to accomplish that? What is your sense of the hope or opportunity for those regulatory adjustments?
They're very hard. Minnesota is a vertically integrated state for their investor-owned utilities, so they own generation. In other states have been restructured so that utilities don't own generation. And owning generation can cause conflicts of interest within the utility. So doing these types of changes equitably when the utility has a stake in it is very difficult.
And what do we do to participate in that, those conversations as consumers? Or
those changes are made at the legislative level primarily.
So does that mean we can't do anything? Or does that mean we talk? What does that mean?
I think that's maybe that you ask Ellen.
Okay.
I have a very specific question for Brian. the technology for the storage for the project that you talked about, what are the likely possibilities? What kind of batteries?
It's probably going to be a lithium ion or a lithium ion mix with lead acid, possibly. We've heard that concept as well.
And what's the sort of the next closest that could become competitive?
It would probably be a flow type technology.
I just had a quick follow-up. So what kinds of characteristics were you looking at when deciding what storage technology to use?
In the last 8 to 10 months, I've realized a new reality. It's not so much about the technology, it's more about the bankability. And right now, to get a project financed, you're pretty much limited to lithium ion batteries in terms of that bankability, and that's what really drives the project.
Just a question on how much energy storage would it take to accomplish a 70% renewable portfolio, both in terms of the peak of the storage and the energy that it would have to store? Anybody have any good feel for that?
There have been studies done for the Minnesota Public Utilities Commission on how, on the level of renewables that is possible. And the levels are very high without storage. So I'm not sure even if you'd need storage because we utilize the MISO markets. So we could integrate a lot of wind on the system.
Yeah, I could just chime in that NREL has done a lot of studies like that. That in California, if you want to have a 50% PV penetration, what storage it will take under different scenarios, you know, so you can get hold of those reports.
I might comment too, both New York State and California seem to be maybe the most advanced in terms of integrating energy storage with their renewables. In normal rule of thumb in the past have been over 45% renewables in those locales. So they certainly wanted to have substantial energy storage to ease any pressure on the grid.
I might as well throw in my two cents on that. The Minnesota study that was referenced, the MRIT study, can be found on the Minnesota Department of Commerce website that did study 40% and 50% penetration of renewables in Minnesota and found that 40% can be done with accommodations to the grid now, right now, and 50%, they didn't analyze it closely and said that's, as Don said, that's the range where you might start thinking about needing some additional storage and other support.
I'm interested in the geographic matchups. So Brian made the point about his storage is going to be near or in the same distribution system as the solar. Ned talked about not sloshing right. electrons across the transmission system. So for Don, there's not a lot of renewable production potential for the Northeast where you're making the pitch for the storage. And it's also not, I mean, there's some demand, but there's not a lot of variable demand compared to larger markets. So I'm wondering how important the location of the storage is to the economics and to the operation of the system.
Yeah, there's actually quite a debate. Do you put the storage where the users are, or do you put the storage near the generation sites? And in the case of Minnesota Power, for example, they have, I think, over 400 megawatts in North Dakota now that they bring back on a DC line to Duluth. So they could take full advantage, for example, of energy storage up on the Iron Range or even in Lake Superior if they use compressed air energy storage. The other thing that we found is the Cuyuna District, which, just as an aside, you know, that's named after Kyler and his dog Una. I always thought that was interesting. Anyway, on the Cuyuna District in Ironton area, you have former legacy mine pits there, and you also have electrical grid connections that could easily be made. So you could actually implement, for example, that compressed air energy storage system of the hydro store type in those bodies of water without disturbing much of anything environmentally. So you do have some interesting features in Minnesota to take advantage of those type of technology at large scale.
Okay, question to Brian.
Right here. You mentioned about your RFP, 10 megawatt solar and 20 megawatt storage. Typically, I thought you have a bigger generation, smaller storage. What's your logic for having bigger storage?
Our logic behind it is to maximize the demand response value to have enough solar to recharge the battery in a back-to-back demand response event to fully take advantage of the ITC. The ITC requires at the end of the year at least 75% of the electrons coming out of the storage system originate from a renewable generation source. And so it's a play to monetize that ITC in a manner that boosts demand response benefits.
So as a follow-up to that, does Conexus have the ITC tax appetite to offset that?
We do not. We're a not-for-profit entity.
All right, we have time for one more question, and there's going to be a reception, so don't worry, you can get your questions answered as well there.
And Kim, since I'm the MC, I'm going to ask one more question too, so I take that prerogative. Go ahead, please.
Just a quick question for the whole panel. It feels like a really aggressive monetization of this whole system could be solved with time of use rates, and I was just curious to see what your comments are on that. Is that kind of the silver bullet? If there was one regulatory-wise, is that it?
That was my question, so way to go.
We're currently working on time of use rates and some of the dockets at the Public Utilities Commission. It would be helpful, but you have to realize that many commercial and industrial customers already have time of use rates, so it'll only impact small businesses and residents. But that's still that graphic that has 13 services that gets at one of them. So you still have many other services that need to be monetized to optimally adopt storage throughout the system. If that makes sense.
All right. Thank you all so much, and we will reconvene outside for the reception. Thank you all for being here, and come join us for a beverage.